The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated, everyone. Please open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Verses 43 to 48. Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 to 48. Everybody, please open your Bibles. Matthew chapter 5. So Jesus's run-in, his argument, his fight, literally with the Pharisees, continues. We saw that it began yesterday with the first of the six hypotheses, and it carries on today. Today's text, of course, deals with the sixth or the last of these hypotheses. It was the Pharisees who interpreted the Torah for about 400 years. In the absence of the prophets until the time of Jesus. Remember, I told you this, that prior to Jesus, for 400 years, there was no prophet, there was no prophecy. What happened at this point of time? At this point of time, the scribes grew. What is the meaning of the word scribe? Somebody who copies. So the scribes were simply copying the sacred texts. Now, because they were the only ones who were learned, who do you go to when you want to consult someone on religious matters who is more learned than you? I presume you go to the priest, you go to the scribe. Now, in their zeal to be mediators, therefore between God and man, the scribes and the Pharisees got the law wrong and the spirit of the law completely wrong. So not only have they misunderstood the law and the understanding of the law, how do you interpret that law? How do you apply that law? Yeah, very often in our parish, we have to make laws, correct? Right? We have to have a law. But very often, you have to, how do you put it? You have to make an exception to that rule sometimes. You look at a particular person and you say, in this case, I don't think the rule applies because I have to look at your heart, not look at the law. So, people get upset. Father, you're breaking the law. This must be your favorite person. No, it's not. You have to always look at the person. Pope Francis says this very, very clearly. Look at the person. Don't just look at the law. The scribes and the Pharisees got it completely wrong because they only looked at the law. They didn't look at the spirit of the law. For Jesus, the law was what I call the least or the lowest common denominator. His expectation from us as Christians was always that we go beyond the law. Remember what I said yesterday? Ye dil mange mo. Jesus wants more. He doesn't say, this is what the law says. Let me give an example. Father, if I'm late for Mass, at what point of time can I enter the Mass and still my Mass is valid? You're bothered about a valid Mass or you're bothered about Mass? What are you bothered about? What are you bothered about? You see, we are bothered about valid Mass. What happens in that mass while I'm sitting there? I could be in London, Tokyo. Is that not important? So when we start asking questions like, at what point of time can I enter church? Many people ask me, at what point of time does the mass begin? So I said, if it's a Sunday mass, it begins the previous Sunday, when after that last Sunday mass, you decided to go for the next Sunday. That's when your Sunday mass began. It begins in your heart. So for the Christian, we are always called to give more. Jesus wants more. And so Matthew's in chapter 5, he will play this out in the next 6 hypotheses. I told you we heard the first. Today we hear the last. There is always a call for more. Jesus wants more. Today's gospel plays out that last of the Ye Dil Mange Mo, the last of the 6 hypotheses. Now, the Pharisees had interpreted the law concerning one's relationship with regard to the neighbor and one's relationship with regard to your enemies in the most conveniently contrived way. Meaning to say, it was done in such a way that it only benefited them. Have you ever seen laws like this? I've seen this very often. Yeah, very often in government offices, I see this. The law is designed not for the good of the people, even though we pray it sometimes in our prayer. It is for the good of that officer who is sitting there. Only that law is designed for him. Yeah, that's why Pope Francis often asks us priests, he says, are you slaves to your office timings? Because you create the law. Something that's always disturbed me, why are our parish offices not opened on a Sunday? Because that's the one day everybody is at home and they can do all their work in the parish, no? But we open on all the days except the day that you want to are free. You get my point. There are good reasons why we close it on a Sunday. But can we not have somebody sitting there taking masses? Can we not? We don't have it in our parishes yet, but I would like to try these experiments in other parishes. Making our church available for people, truly available for people. So, what did the scribes and Pharisees do? They used these laws in their own convenient, contrived way. What did they do? They mandated that one was to love one's neighbor. This is what they said. We have to love our neighbor. And they said next, we have to hate our enemies. Now, interestingly, this very popular quote of theirs, I say popular because it was not in the Bible, was interpreted by the Pharisees and lived by the Jews, was really an incomplete presentation of what the actual law said. What did they say? You must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Not true. Why? Where do we find the laws? In the book of Leviticus. In the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 18, please go and read it. Chapter 19, verse 18. The source of this popular saying on neighbors and enemies actually called, listen to this, for the love of the neighbor to be in the same measure as one loved oneself. Okay? So I love you just the way I love myself. A section that was very conveniently omitted by the Pharisees. What did the Pharisees say? Love your neighbor and hate your enemies. So let's come to the hate your enemies part. First of all, they've dropped something. Now, there was no reference anywhere in Leviticus 19, anywhere in the law about hating one's enemies. Nowhere in the law did it say, hate one's enemies. Again, this was an addition that the Pharisees put in. It was an addition. So it didn't say anywhere about hating one's enemies. They had simply added this on. They had added this on. And by this, they control people. So what was the agenda really of the Pharisees? The agenda of the Pharisees, why did they mislead the people with these half-truths? Why did they limit the law of love only to one's neighbors? Why did they do this? The Pharisees effectively limited the understanding of one's neighbor only to a fellow Jew. And by doing this, they officially signaled, or rather they signaled that all non-Jews, therefore, were the enemy. See what they did, huh? It's very clever. By saying, I only have to love my neighbor, they said, anybody who's not my neighbor is my enemy. And therefore, if you were not my neighbor, you were my enemy, therefore I have the permission to hate you. And this is nothing but state-sponsored hate. This is what many governments are doing today. They are asking you, what is your religion? And if this is not your religion, then your neighbor is not your neighbor, he is your enemy. And therefore, if your neighbor is your enemy, you can hate your enemy. You see, this is not something new. This goes back to the time of Jesus. This very narrow ethnocentric framework exists today even. Sadly, we see it lived out in distinctions made on the basis of your race, on the distinction of your color, on the distinctions of your nationality, on the distinctions of your religion, which is very strongly happening in our country. You're denied as much as you want. And many of us are today silent in this country because we don't want to upset people lest we are sent like Father Stan Swamy to jail. Today in this country, you're sent to jail for anything. Thank God for that judge recently who gave such a fantastic ruling and says we are not here to pander to the ego of the government. People have a right to speak out. People have a right to oppose their government, especially when their government does not work in line and with falling with the constitution of this country, when it works against people, it works in division of people. Don't forget what Hitler did, and the whole world kept quiet. And we are becoming a quiet nation. We are afraid. I am afraid. But when are we going to stand up and become prophets? When are we going to accept the martyrdom that is going to come to us? Why are we all quiet? You know, the shrill voices of world leaders trumpeting such philosophies grows globally, and all in the name of nationalism. Our country, our country, our country. By the way, it's happening all over the world. I don't know whether if you read history, it happened in the early 1900s also. Nationalism. Countries united against other countries. Why did World War I happen? Please read history. Please read it. It's nationalism. Why did the Second World War happen? Nationalism. Make no mistake, the bigots exist not only on the side sometimes of governments, but on our side also. And often these bigots take the form of terror in the name of God, whatever God they think they have cultivated in their head. Such a mandate to hate our neighbor leads to a bigoted human race, and our world has become too fragile for bigots. The Pharisees come alive every day, even in our days. When we become people who begin to hate our neighbors based on their religion, their caste, their creed. And believe me, we Catholics are not far behind. Every time you ask somebody, are you a Goan, a Mangalorean, or an East Indian, or an Anglo-Indian, first ask yourself, why are you asking that question? What business do you have to ask that question? What business do you have? If you're a Mangalorean, then you're my best friend. Is that what it is? Why, a Christian is not good enough? A human being is not good enough? Who is creating this? And Jesus speaks out against this. He speaks out about it very strongly. The call of Jesus to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us is not some hopeless idealism, but it's a very wise strategy for overcoming the persecutor. The heroic stance of the martyr gives the persecutor a very bad image, and it's very hard for governments to control. Shaming people with love, that was Jesus' strategy. That's what he said, no? If they slap you on one cheek, what do? Give them the other cheek. Shame them with love. People have misunderstood this. They think that Catholics, when you slap them, you must give the other. No. Understand what Jesus says. He says, you offer them the other cheek. So that they feel ashamed. They want your cloak, no? Make yourself nanga. Take my coat also. Take everything. Go. So that the person, imagine that. Yeah? You're saying, I'm taking your coat away. I take out all my clothes. I'm naked now. Say, take. That fellow will run away. Unless, of course, he wants to see a naked person. Those crackpots also we have. Shame them, says Jesus. This is the strategy, and this is seen in the lives of the early Christian martyrs who gave late antiquity a bad conscience, because if you see in the lives of the martyrs, they tried this stunt with the martyrs. And what did the martyrs do? Said, you want my life, nah? You want my life? Take it. That's all you want, nah? Take it. How many lives will you take? No dictator in this world has lasted forever. He's lasted, never forever. Our reward, if any, must be the belief that in the eyes of God, we are called, as Jesus says, I call you to be perfect. This perfection is not to be misunderstood as not having any fault, but rather the Christian calling to be blameless. The word perfect in scripture is teleos, to be blameless, to be holy before the Lord in our dealings with our neighbor. If our love is going to be limited to those of our own race, if we are only going to love our own people, if we are only going to love people of our own mindset, if we are only going to love people of our own faith, then we have already received an earthly reward. We have received an award from that person who says, are you Mangalorean? I say I'm Mangalorean. We both hug each other. You've got your reward. We receive only the love of the person who is of the same mind as we are. And it ends there. But, and please listen to this big but. If we love those who hate us, our reward is what? It is an increase in God's love for us. When I love my enemy, it is an increase in God's love for me. And that is what Jesus is calling us. I want to end this homily today with a word of thanks to Preetam Rodericks, who has been with us, working with us for the last 11 months. Today is his last working day with us. In this time, he also got married. But Preetam came to us in a very difficult time. The pandemic, around the 12th of March, we had already closed down our church. And Preetam decided to help us out. And by the 22nd, when we had completely shut down, he decided to move in, live in, help us. At that point of time, if you remember, we did not even know how to broadcast a mass. We were doing it with Facebook without even a wire, without a mic. And since then, he has been with us. And I am very grateful for the love that he has shown us, his presence with us, practically spending every moment of these 11 months. I'm grateful, Preetam, and happy and thankful that, yes, everybody has to move on. We can't hold on to you forever. And it's good in a way. Life has many challenges, but I commend you into the hands of Jesus. You will always be ours, and I always say to you, you will always be my son. I may have never given birth to you, but I have loved you as only a father can love a son. And that includes shouting at you from time to time. Today is also a day when I pray in a special way for my niece. She turns 13. Many of you, I've been here 10 years in this parish. She was 3 years old when I came here. Many of you have met her. And Sienna is 13 today, and she's God's wonderful gift to our family. And I, happy birthday, Sienna. If I know you'll be watching this mass with your mommy and daddy, I want to say how happy our family is and how blessed we are to have you, the loving, kind, considerate child that you have grown up to be. May Jesus bless you always. This is my prayer for you, that our Lord and our Blessed Mother, as you step into your teenage years, guide, guard, and protect you.